All right. But let's talk about theoretical physicist Stephen Hawking, who built on Einstein's ideas to provide further support for the idea that the universe had a beginning. So he didn't want to do that, but that's what he ended up doing.
Well, it's a fascinating story, actually. And it's told nicely in the little film, Theory of Everything, about Hawking's life.
And I would say it's also told beautifully in this book, folks, that we're going to be offering, Return of the God Hypothesis. Just came out. Stephen wrote it. It's over 500 pages. A lot of people that are in this book, you know personally, and you've interviewed them. What I love about it is the clarity for the layperson who wants to know, what is general relativity? What is special relativity? How was it developed? What were the implications? And when we get to what we're talking about right now with Stephen Hawking, you lay all of this out beautifully, and I'm just saying, it's a very, very valuable book. That's why it's a bestseller. So, well, continue from there.
Thank you, but it is a wonderful story about Hawking. He's a grad student at Cambridge doing his PhD in physics in the 1960s, the early 1960s. And he, of course, becomes afflicted with ALS, the Lou Gehrig's disease.
Lou Gehrig's.
But he decides, after some personal reflection, to continue. And during his PhD years, he comes up with an idea that applies Einstein's theory of general relativity to our understanding of cosmology, of the origin of the universe. And he realizes that if Einstein's idea is true, that massive bodies curve space, then as the universe is expanding, as we know it is from the observational astronomy, then space is getting less and less curved because the matter of the universe is getting more and more diffuse. But then he begins to think about, well, what would the condition have been like in the universe at any progressive point back in the past? At each point, the matter would be more densely concentrated, and therefore space would be more tightly curved. And as you go back a million years, a billion years, eventually, however far back you go, you're going to reach a point where that matter is congealing into that starting point. But at that point, space is going to be getting really, really tightly curved, and eventually you're going to reach a limiting case where the density of matter is so compact and space is so tight that space goes to an infinite curvature. And an infinitely curved spatial volume corresponds to something that's so small that you can't put anything in it. It corresponds to a zero spatial volume, which is now what physicists call the singularity, the point from which the universe sprang forth. What Hawking did was very technical. He solved something called the field equations of general relativity in order to prove that this singularity must have been the starting point of the universe, that the universe must have started in a singularity of zero spatial
and
volume.
What were all the ingredients that went back in this little singularity? You got matter, you got space, you got time. What else was back
well,
in there?
Well, the idea, really intuitively or philosophically, if you think about it, is that once you get to a point of infinite curvature, then you're also to a point of zero spatial volume. You have no space into which you can put anything. And so the picture of the origin of the universe based on general relativity and the solution of Einstein's equations by Hawking and later in collaboration with George Ellis and Roger Penrose is a picture that implies the universe coming into existence out of literally nothing physical, like the old medieval theological concept of creatio ex nihilo,
creation out of nothing.
And so this was mind-blowing, and Hawking realized that if this were true, this had powerful anti-materialistic implications, because prior to the origin of matter, space, time, and energy, there would be no matter, space, time, or energy to do the causing of the origin of the universe. Therefore, if you want to have a causal explanation for the origin of the universe, you would need to think about something that transcends those domains of matter, space, time, and energy. You need to posit an entity which is not bound by space and time, and which is not material. And to a lot of scientists, that sounded an awful lot like God, especially when you consider that there is an abrupt change of state at the beginning from nothing to everything that exists.
Yeah.
And that suggests a volitional act, that what would be required to explain the origin of the universe from that point of singularity would be an entity that transcends matter, space, time, and energy, and which is capable of exercising volition to cause a change of state.